on the things that your children are not learning in school that you might now might have a great chance to teach them, particularly if it's about money. But it seems that Party Next Door managed to drag her into a studio, and they've got a new track together called Believe It. This is, of course, Party Next Door featuring Rihanna. When we come back, we'll be talking about what's happening in this week's business and finance news.
Oh,
where often when we're getting started in business, we do kind of need that help. And often with us girlies as well, we're really good at getting the business done and, you know, doing really good work, but are we able to scale our businesses? So NatWest will match the fund, they say, up to by 50% of the initial crowdfunding target to the maximum of £5,000, which isn't too bad. And the bank has actually pledged £174,000 in the Midlands and the East of England so far, and said that it hopes to that the Back Her Business would go towards reducing the gender gap when it came to entrepreneurship. And indeed, let's hope that it continues to do that. Do you know what I have to say? Interestingly, like, that's something that's really close to my heart at the moment. I launched on my YouTube channel yesterday a new series called Support a Sister. Yes. And the purpose of that is that there's so many great Black women and women of colour running businesses that just don't get the platform and don't get anybody actually bigging them up. And instead we use statements like, oh, let's support her in business, or let's support Black businesses, or let's support female businesses. And it's like, do you know what? Let's not support them. Let's just buy from them, because they are hot, they are great, they are run by formidable people, and they are actually putting out really great products and services. And let's actually start to talk about our businesses on that level rather than something that needs, you know, aid. Anyway, so it's really encouraging to see anyway what NatWest are doing, and maybe they can support a few of our businesses, or maybe give a girl a little sponsorship, who knows. Anyway, but the Bounce Back Loan Scheme, of course, which has been one of the initiatives established by the government throughout this coronavirus period for small businesses, have revealed that they've got new lenders that they've added to their existing quota. So we're talking about Allied Irish Bank, the Cooperative Bank, and Starling Bank. And I'm particularly impressed to see Starling on there, because I think one of the issues with new banks and online banks and app-based banks and all of these sorts of institutes is that they weren't necessarily getting the same sort of kudos as the high street banks. So it's really positive to see them there. Now, if you haven't heard of this is a scheme that's intended to target small and micro businesses in all sectors with loans from between £2,000 to £50,000. The fund is administered by the UK's Government Economic Development Bank, and it sits alongside the Corona Business Interruption Loan Scheme, the CBILS, which provides funds of up to 5 million for SMEs, and its coronavirus large business interruption loan scheme, which provides funding, of course, for bigger firms up to 50 million. Now, the three new lenders which have joined will also be added to the Bank of Scotland, Barclays, Clydesdale Bank and Yorkshire Bank, Danske Bank, HSBC, Lloyds Bank, NatWest, Santander, TSB, RBS and Ulster. So you can see that it's a nice little roster there. And the BBL scheme has a 100% guarantee from the Treasury in the event of default. So what that basically means is that people who are applying for those loans are effectively getting them straight away, because the government said, listen, don't even worry about running no credit checks on these people. We will back them. Now, let me just put the disclaimer out there for all the people who just heard what I said and started Googling or using some kind of search engine to find the loan, okay? I honestly would say to small businesses, if you want to take, as they say, good advice from an old fool, that only pick up one of these loans if you really do need it, okay? Because the trick is in the name, loan, okay? You're gonna have to pay it back. And what you don't want to do is to get some unnecessary money, struggle to pay it back when the time comes, and then find yourself in a situation where, because you default or what have you, that then's gonna impact your ability to do future business or to get future credit. So if you really don't need it, you know, if it's a little bit like it's a nice to have, then I would refrain. If it's a, my business is not going to survive the forthcoming period if I do not have this, that's the time to pick up the application form and to get it done. But what's positive is I have been hearing about these loans being honoured and being administered really, really quickly. So there's definitely there as a lifeline for you as businesses if it is required. But as my mum would say, and I'm going to use a little bit of her vernacular when I say it, now take the people their money if you can't pay it back. That's what I would say, okay? Just be careful of that. Right, let's keep it moving. Now, it seems that more than £5 billion has been funded, as we talk about these funds, to firms under the UK government flagship COVID-19 support initiative. It really intrigues me that they call it a flagship scheme. Listen, Well, you know what? I can't even give you a full economics lesson here, but what I'm going to say is this. At the end of the day, if the government is backing our businesses to borrow money, it's for a reason. And it's always a good idea for you to have a good understanding as to what the financial mechanisms are behind some of these decisions, so that you understand how it really benefits you both, not just in the short term, but also in the long term. So just be mindful of that. It's good that these businesses, as I say, are getting access to the money. And I think the government want to publicise that because they want people to know that, hey, we're doing something and it's working. Lenders, at the point of this article being written, which was a few days ago, has received over 62,500 completed applications. Over half of those have been approved. More applications are being processed at present and expected to be approved in coming days. And while the government this week is looking at the bounce back loan, do also note that they're also going through the process of administering what's going to be the self-employment support fund, which is so basically the equivalent of the furlough scheme of the 80%, but for people who are self-employed. So they're in the process of also looking at how they're going to administer those, so that they can ensure that, all being well, the money which is due out at some point in June, I believe later in June, can actually be paid out. But more to the point, self-employed people can get an indication at it over the course of this month as to what payments they can expect. When we come back, I'm going to be telling you what's not so hot this week. But in the meantime, this one's called Givenchy Bag, and it's from Wiley featuring Future Chip and Nate Smalls. This is not the time to be buying one of those with the government's money. Just be mindful of that, okay? Financial stuff makes sense. What's hot and what's not? It's 25 past 10 here on New Star Radio 98.7 FM. Welcome back. Still to come this morning, your 5 in 5 is all about ways in which to reinvent your marketing strategy for the digital platforms that you may want to engage with during this period. And later on in Life and Style, I want to talk to you about some practical lessons that you can teach your children about how to get a financial leg up, which they're probably not going to learn at school, and therefore... But for now, let's take a look at what's not so hot this morning or in this week's business and financial news. It seems that the Bank of England has warned of a massive hit to the economy from the coronavirus. Now, you know, there's different ways that I could say, really? Shocking. Yeah, and I'm going to keep it PG and clean and put it like that. But seriously, as if we didn't already have an inkling that something might be awry. Bank experts, and it took an expert, so there will be very sharp falls in GDP and a substantial increase in unemployment. Now, there is a suggestion that some of the figures I've heard is that for every month that this continues, 1.5%, that they're predicting a 1.5% fall in GDP, that's gross domestic produce, okay? And that is not going to be a good thing. What that means in English is that little word called recession, which is very much a technical term and refers to an economy contracting, therefore becoming smaller, is basically happening. It's just that for it to be called a recession, it has to happen, that they have to see that contraction for 3 consecutive months. And then it becomes a recession. But technically speaking, we're already there, people. Do you know what I mean? Because we see this, we're feeling this already. We already know for the people who have managed to cut, for example, their household outgoings because they're not spending so much on fuel and on various different businesses that we would normally be spending lots of money on, that within itself suggests quite a lot. Anyway, so the banks say that it expects GDP to fall by about 3% in the first 3 months of this year and then plunge by about 25% in the second quarter, which is massive, although it has caused over uncertainty over the forecasts. Now, in its first official outlook on the toll taken on the UK economy by COVID-19 and the pandemic, the bank has cautioned over this very sharp fall, which could lead to a substantial hike in unemployment. It said the fall should be temporary and that activity should pick up relatively rapidly as the lockdown is eased, but it has added that it would take some time for the economy to recover. And it will. And I think that we have to be realistic that in the same way that, you know, release from lockdown doesn't mean that we can all go to a house party next week, is going to be in the same way that we can't assume that because a shop is reopening that means everything's going to be okay immediately. It is going to take a little bit of time to come back into line, and I think we need to be realistic in setting our expectations for that, and as business owners really need to be very strategic in the way that we plan for it, hence why we're going to talk about some of the things we're going to talk about in a little bit. So small firms have been urging the government to look again at the support available to them. You know, again, the government wants small firms to pay attention to this discretionary fund. The small firms want the government to pay attention to how much money they're dishing out. But effectively, the new grants that are being distributed by the local authority and are being designed to help these sorts of organisations, the government is saying, please do pay attention to. Now, I would say that, you know, there is always, as much as the government's talking about, oh yeah, we're lending out loads of money, we're backing it, it's great, I would be saying to people, try to get a grant first, because again, the hint is in the name. A grant, you don't necessarily have to pay back, well, you invariably are not paying it back. A loan is our borrows, you're paying it back. So you want to be mindful about how you go about doing that and what that's actually going to look like, and how much you can afford to pay back, because like I say, recovery isn't going to mean immediate bounce back ability, as it were. But it's quite interesting. The government are saying, listen, look again, pay attention. And I would say, you know, if at first you did not succeed, dust yourself off and try again. Yes, I stole that lyric, but do try again. Right. The number of firms going bust, they say, is going to tumble as government support kicks in. So again, this research now comes from KPMG. They're saying that firms may face greater risk of the economy. is, because do you know what? It's a little bit like going to the gym, in that a lot of these companies, their health throughout this period is linked to what they were like when they first went into it. So if they were in a relatively fit condition, you know, let's say it was a company that was quite robust, they've been in a pretty good position, you know, i.e., I don't know, you've done a few star jumps in the house for a couple of months and then you've gone and ventured into the gym, your performance at the gym is going to be better than if you just spent like 3 months sitting on the sofa eating cake. It's just one of those. And it's the same thing with companies. It's like, if they were quite robust in the first instance, they will fare okay. If they weren't and they were on the brink of struggling anyway, then you're going to find that those are the ones that will have collapsed first. And that's been noted in the sorts of organizations that we have seen collapse in recent weeks. So, you know, the point being is things will slow down. And why that's important, I think, is that whilst it's not great that it's happening in the first place, it should start to set people's minds at ease that the longer your organization weathers this, the more likely they are to weather the storm overall. But as you can imagine, consumer confidence has plummeted. And we're in a position now where, as families, we're doing our best to save pennies. Now, it's interesting to me because I think there's a lot of talk about people saving pennies. I think there's just people who are broke. Like, and I don't even say that in any kind of negative, condescending way. Like, there are people struggling. Fact, do you know what I mean? Because now, in some instances, households have gone potentially up to nearly 2 months with very little or no income. When that is the case, things are, you don't have it to spend, you know. And I mean, I don't think you can buy 15 pence cola anymore, but I know in the past you could, because I've does mean that families and people are feeling the pressure to penny pinch, and that is natural. So I'm more concerned about the fact that you've got people who are financially struggling in general than I am worried about consumer confidence, because consumer confidence is linked to consumer ability. When we're broke, we ain't got no confidence in anything or anyone. And the only thing we're confident of is that we need some money. This is it. But if you're listening this morning, hopefully you'll get some ideas by the end of the show. And finally, it seems that the airports are wanting a tapered end to furloughing to avoid mass redundancies. So bearing in mind that a lot of airlines have pretty much ground to a halt and have been grounded during this entire period, they're saying to the government, listen, don't just unleash them back into work and expect us to pay these bills. It ain't going to work that way, which makes sense because a lot of us are not going to be able to travel to the extent that we would have wanted to. I mean, don't get me wrong, everybody who can afford a holiday is going to try to get one. I know that I will definitely be trying to get one, but I also think there's going to be restrictions to international travel probably for a little while, so that's going to impact airlines further. So it's not, as I say, going to go back to normal straight away. And I think setting those sorts of expectations are really important. The airports are saying, listen, government, help us out, because if that's the case, we're still going to end up having to make a load of people redundant anyway. It's all going on, unfortunately, still dominated by Corona. But as I say, when we come back this morning, I'm going to be giving you some ideas on how you can reinvent your digital marketing strategy. And a little bit later on, I'm going to be telling you about some financial lessons that this crisis can teach us, so that, you know, let's face it, there'll be another recession. Let's hope there isn't Rona again. We don't want her to come back. But there will be another recession. And when there is, let's be better prepared for it next time. More after this.
Birmingham's number one for African arts, culture and Afro edutainment. 98.7.
It's the Financial Style on New Style Radio 98.7 FM, making money.
0.7 FM. I'm Marisha, here with you now until midday. Actually, what goes on in the studio, the drama and watch me live this morning. Studio. And here's how I'll know that you're watching. If you are, put a little comment and say what colour I'm wearing. What colour am I wearing today? Okay. Now, it seems that branding has been something of a concern for many small businesses in recent weeks who actually are trying to catch up with this digital marketing takeoff. Now, let's be realistic. Before Rona decided to give us all a little visit, many small businesses had some kind of internet presence, whether that was via social media or their own website. But maybe what they weren't doing so much of was interacting so much and engaging so much with customers in a digital and social, particularly digital space. And so this morning's 5 in 5, which is where we like to give 5 tips for 5 things in about 5 minutes that might be of interest to you, is to talk to you about ways in which you can brand yourself to reinvent your digital marketing strategy, because it's no longer about having the occasional advert pop up to let people know that your business is on the high street or that, you know, you're doing something. Actually, now it is the only way at present that many organizations are actually engaging with their customer base. So the very first thing, if you're not already there, is just get digital, go digital. So many people now are spending so much time on social media platforms than they ever have before. It's a really great way to interact and transact with your audience. And one of the things I would honestly say, and this is, and I'm saying this as somebody who feels like I'm being a bit overly digitized, okay, is that this is actually more about you engaging with your existing clientele and your existing audience than worrying about necessarily gaining new people when it comes to going digital, particularly if you're bricks and mortar business, because this is about keeping hold of the people that you have. Now, if you get new people in the mix to start with, then that is great. But as a starting point, use it as a mechanism to communicate with your existing customers. And why I'm saying that is because as somebody right now who is linked to all sorts of organizations, and I keep an eye on lots of businesses, and I have lots of friends in business and all the rest of it, I am Instagram, Facebook, and Facebook lived out. Like, at the minute, I'm just tired. I'm tired of Instagram Live. I'm tired of Facebook Live. I'm tired. And it's not that I don't want to engage with people. It's just, it's a lot and it's every day. And, you know, it seems like 9 o'clock. 9 o'clock is the golden hour. Like, 9 o'clock every evening, lives go crazy. And my point is that actually for somebody who's not already engaged with you, it can be overwhelming unless it's a point of interest. So focus on using it to engage with people who you already know. But then, if you want to start attracting new customers, what you want to think about is your strategy in doing so. So the first thing is about being compassionate. You know, we're in a place at the moment where people are experiencing lots of different things and lots of different emotions with it. So we want to try and show them compassion through our brand. It's not the time to just try and blatantly take advantage of a situation. It's actually a really good time to start thinking about what value can I add to my customer base? What can I give? What can I do? Rather than just what can I take, what can I get, and how can I benefit? Think about rethinking your offerings, okay? So again, you may not be able to deliver your services in exactly the same way as you've done previously. So this is a really good time to think about giving something else. If you are, for example, a hairdresser and you're not able to do people's hair, this might be a really good time for you to start advising, giving people information, talking about the knowledge that you have of hair and how that can apply to individuals in the short term, even if the only thing you're doing is teaching them how to do the minimum amount of harm as possible to their heads until they can get back to you. So just think about how you can rethink the offering that you have. And if you're able to do something practical, then great. But if not, then use that medium as a space to, you know, become knowledge rich and value rich in terms of how you share knowledge. Where possible, support a cause. You know, I think these days people love to see that we're all standing up for something and supporting something. Every Thursday, you've got people coming out of their homes to clap for the NHS, for example. But are there other causes out there or other charities or local-based organisations that you can offer support to? And whether that is your local church all the way through to maybe a global organisation, think about doing that and how that may affiliate with the ethos of your organisation and the mission that you have. Because a lot of times, and one thing I do know, particularly, and I put this to particularly women in business, men, I'm not cussing you, I'm not running you down, I'm just saying it's a characteristic I find often with women, is that often women's businesses are very much born from a need or an issue or a problem that they themselves encountered that then they sought to resolve and then offered it as a service. And why I say that is because then it's very easy to link those businesses with causes. So one business that comes to mind, for example, is One Fit Mama. Great business, arose out of a woman having postnatal depression and wanting to help other ladies who are experiencing it with exercise with their babies, but then supporting the cause of helping moms, or you know, moms who are disadvantaged, for example, then becomes a way for them to support a cause that's in line with their ethos. That's what I'm making reference to. And think about how you can solve pertinent issues, okay? So again, what are the issues and the challenges that people are facing right here, right now? And how does that become something that you can be active in resolving and helping them to resolve? So that might be an advice thing, that might be a guidance thing, that might just be about putting information online, maybe on your website or on social media that you've never actually put there before. Just thinking about how you solve people's problems, and also how you're going to solve their problems when we do start to come out of lockdown and things start to go back to normal, because it is likely that those problems will be more exasperated than when we went into lockdown. So have a little think about those few things that you can do. You know, first of all, make sure you are digital. Don't do every platform. Focus on a couple so that you can be consistent. Be compassionate to your customer base. Rethink what your offering is in order to give them as much help, support and guidance as possible. Support a cause where you can that's in line with your business ethos, and show ways in which you can resolve pertinent issues. I'm always open to knowing more about the sorts of subjects that you want to know about and the things that are going to help you and your business. So please do not hesitate to get in touch and let me know what sort of thing you would want 5 tips on that are going to help you either in your personal life or in your business life, and certainly in a way that's going to put you in a position where you can prosper moving forward. Now, I haven't played this one for a little while. It's Miss Mariah Carey. It seems that she stepped out the other night with her boo in tow. and say, you see, this is the thing. You know, someone said it to me the other day, actually. And, you know, I was talking about how to prosper in a time like this. And she said, how can you think about that, as you know, at such a time? You know, money is not the most important thing. And no, it's not. It isn't. But if you can come out of this a little bit richer than when you went in, is it not worth figuring out how? So I'm going to talk to you about that this morning in this morning's Millionaire Mindset, because in every downturn, there are lots of opportunities, and there are going to be opportunities and ways in which we can benefit from the economic downturn that we are experiencing and will further experience over coming months. And if you're homeschooling, this is a really great opportunity for you to teach your kids the sort of stuff that they're not learning at school anyway. Because let's be realistic, when they go back to school, they're going to learn about Bunsen burners and, you know, stuff like that. I started thinking about physics, but I don't remember what all the stuff's called, so we're not going to go there. But yeah, it's been a long time since I've been at school, let's just put it like that. But they're going to learn about all that sort of stuff. But what are they not going to learn about? Well, they might not learn how to be more financially savvy. So we're going to talk a little bit about kids and the lessons that you can teach them whilst they are at home. And actually, some of those lessons will probably be quite practical at this moment in time. But if you're running a business, and or you're a manager in an organization, it is very likely that at present you're having to lead people remotely. And that's not always the easiest thing to do. And if you're particularly used to being somebody who, you know, is a little bit of a, you know, got your foot on their neck type manager, you know, we politely call them micromanagers. We impolitely call them other things, okay? Then you might really be struggling with this. Or actually, if you're running your own business, and again, normally you're used to having oversight of what people are doing, and all of a sudden now you don't know whether they're actually watching daytime television or actually doing your work, then I wanted to talk you through some of the mistakes that you might be making when it comes actually down to supporting your team. And I say that because this has impacted me as well. I have people that work for me and work with me. And, you know, there comes a point where you do have to have a level of flexibility. And this is the time to recognize that we are not all the same creature and we don't all work in the same way. So how can you avoid some of the mistakes? Now, often I think the first one is that people get too rigid. So it becomes a situation where you're working remotely, you know, they start saying things to you like, you know, you should get up in the morning and get ready for work, and, you know, ladies, put on a face of makeup, and gents, you know, put on a shirt and tie and make it feel like you're ready for work. Well, first of all, I'm not doing that. Okay, let me tell you, I've sat in the meeting with my scarf on my head. It was a nice scarf, but I was keeping it on. I'm just saying. So you got to be careful that you're not too rigid with stuff like that, and you don't try and take it to the normal 9 to 5. I think what you have to now work out for people is how they are productive. So for some team members, they're more productive in the morning. I'm one of those people, and actually become less productive as I go through the day because tiredness kicks in or I get distracted by things, quite frankly. But for other people, lots of regular little breaks are the things that help them to be more productive. So this is a time when you don't want to be rigid, and what you want to actually do is ask people what it is that they need and what ways in which they can be supported for a way that they work. So I know, for example, one individual who works with me at present has lots of little breaks, and that's okay. I haven't got a problem with that. He will work later in the day than maybe the rest of the team because he's taken more frequent breaks during it. Now, my thing is, as long as I can have my break to do my workout, I don't care about the rest kind of thing. I'm not even that fussed about lunchtime necessarily, but, you know, because of everything going on. So we work at different patterns, but because we know this, we know when we can communicate and we know when to leave each other alone. Second thing is, a failure to communicate, and this is where I say in general can be a problem. So again, instead of just leaving people to their own devices, because you get two types of managers. You get the manager who is in your face 24/7, being Mr. or Mrs. Rigid, and then you get the person who you just don't ever hear from. Now, if you're like me, then that might not bother you. But actually, to check on the well-being of people, and for a lot of people who actually do appreciate interaction, this is where not communicating with them for long periods of time can also be problematic. It's also being about respectful of everybody else's time. I think sometimes the mistakes that managers can make in particular and leaders make is that they become disrespectful of other people's time. So one of the things I saw happen, particularly when lockdown was really fresh, is that people would just like literally think it was okay to just put a whole smattering of Zoom meetings in my diary when they felt like it. And I'm like, no, like I actually have a schedule. I have things to do. I'm not available to speak to you at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. At that point, I'm virtually done. I don't want to talk to you or anybody, frankly. And if I was in the office, we wouldn't have a meeting at that time. So don't be disrespectful of people's times. And think about the fact that, particularly if you're in different parts of the world or different parts of the country, that those time differences could be quite significant. Or for example, you know, you haven't got kids or your kids are grown up, so you can have a meeting at 8 a.m. in the morning, but then you're dealing with somebody who, for example, has got young children who at 8 o'clock in the morning, they're trying to drag them out of bed, you know, shove Rice Krispies down their mouths and get them moving for the day. So you just want to be mindful of what you're dealing with. So don't be disrespectful of other people's time. In terms of socially disconnecting, so, you know, again, remote teams still need to socialize, and I think it's important that they're given times to do that. So, you know, and I've noticed that actually, my thing is, this is the thing that's bad though, generally speaking, I don't really socialize with people that I work with. I think it's fair to say that's a black thing. Like, we just don't really do that. So for me, I've not been attending the office Zoom lunchtime party because I ain't got no time for that. Okay, I've got other things to do at that point. However, for many employees, that's a really good thing to do and something that they want to feel part of. So even if it's not your cup of tea, don't discount it because it might be beneficial to others. Remember to give people feedback and remember to support them and aid them with learning opportunities. Actually, working from home at the moment is a really good time to encourage people to learn more and to have a bit more space to actually take on board more knowledge, to develop themselves and better their skills. So this is a really good time where actually doing that and remembering to engage in that process is important. If your team members are struggling, don't not address it, don't ignore it, and don't like shout them out in front of people as well. I've definitely been in meetings where there's been embarrassing moments where people have gone, oh yeah, and so and so, you know, has experienced this, or so and so's had to take a break because of that. Don't do that, because, you know, just because that person's remote doesn't mean that they won't feel some kind of way about it, and actually they're going to resent you for it. They're not going to want to work with you, and you'll find them to be less cooperative. And I would say, finally, think about using the right tools. This is not the time to necessarily bombard people with lots of tech. This program for this app for that, it's not necessarily the right time to do all of that, but there is nothing wrong in making sure that they do have suitable tools in place to get their job done appropriately. We have hit the top of the hour. As I say, still lots to come in the second hour here of The Financial Style. And if you are listening on air at the moment, 98.7 FM, or via the TuneIn app or listen live online, then also know that you can check me out this morning. Bit of a one-off on YouTube, on the New Style Live feed. You can say hey, and I want you to let me know if you are listening by telling me what color I am wearing in the studio this morning. And you're only gonna know that if you actually go to the YouTube live, otherwise you are not gonna know. Anyway, when we come back, we can start talking about some financial lessons that we can learn during this pandemic, so when there's another recession, we don't go through the same pains again. So don't go anywhere.
Birmingham's number one for African arts, culture, and Afro edutainment. 98.7 News.
Financial Style on New Style Radio 98.7 FM. Making money makes sense.
It's 10 past 11 here on New Star Radio 98.7 FM. How are you doing this morning? Are you enjoying the sunshine? Isn't it interesting that ever since we've been in lockdown, all of the bank holidays have been blissful? I don't know if that's a form of torture or if that's actually the universe giving us a little bit of a something back. Like, do you know what? They're stuck indoors. At least let them go out in the garden. You know, that sort of thing. Anyway, I'm Marisha here with you now until midday. Just want to say good morning to some of you watching on the YouTube live for New Style. So New Style Live. We're on that live this morning. Bit of a one-off, so you can see me. And those of you recognising that, yes, what colour I'm wearing, I'm not going to say it for all the people out there who are not watching so they can get themselves tuned on. So yes, good morning Deb, thank you so much, really appreciate your comments. Morning Maya, how are you and your gorgeous baby? Miss you guys so much, can't wait to see you guys again. And good morning to Roger, and thank you so much for your comments as well. So do remember, you can check it out on YouTube, New Style Radio Live, and that's where we are at the moment for Financial Style. Now, unfortunately, our health has not been the only thing to suffer during this coronavirus pandemic. For most people, finances in some way, shape or form have taken a hit and actually demonstrated to us some of the most important lessons that we really need to consider taking forward. Because here's the thing. If we ever want to predict the future, a very good predictor of the future is looking at the past. And one of the things that you'll notice if you look at the financial trends for the past 50 years is that generally speaking, in each decade, we have had some kind of recession to a level of severity or not, as the case may be. Now, what's happening here at the beginning of the 20s? 2020, gosh. Remember when you used to hear about the 20s, it was in a history lesson at school. Now we're in the 20s again, creating history that we know our kids and grandkids are going to be studying in a few years' time. But anyway, but here we are at the beginning of the 20s, and we are about to actually have one of the greatest recessions, one could argue, for probably about 100 years, if not more. And I mean, we're talking about the sort of thing that we were experiencing as a country when we had had a war. Now, in this instance, it's a war on a virus. But what lessons can we learn from this? Because let's be realistic, in about 10 years' time, maybe 15 if we're lucky, there's going to be another recession. So how do we ensure that during financial downturns, we can actually fare a little bit better? Well, let's think about some of the lessons that we're learning so far. So the first thing is that overconfidence has led to very poor financial decision making. And that's not just on the part of us as individuals. That's actually been something that's massively emphasized by businesses. Because if you're a business that's turning over thousands, hundreds of thousands, millions or tens of millions of pounds each week, month or year, why would it be that you could be put out of business simply by not having any income for, say, a month or even three? That suggests that because we're so confident that more money is going to keep coming in, what are we doing? We're making poor financial decisions and spending all the money. So instead of us putting a little bit into savings or having that emergency fund or working out actually how we're going to, you know, what we can do to invest that money or get it working for us, instead we think, do you know what? I know I've got a guaranteed paycheck next week. And so for that reason, I can spend off the money. I can buy those extra pair of shoes. I can buy that extra cake at the supermarket. I can give the kids a little bit extra to take to school. I can send them on the school trip or whatever the case may be. And it's not to say that we shouldn't be doing those things, but the reality of the matter is that because we've been confident, we make poorer decisions. Now, it's really interesting to me, actually, that employed people are probably maybe finding themselves in slightly more difficult circumstances than some self-employed people. Because when you're self-employed and you know that your income actually is uncertain, you are going to be more conscious of your outgoings and ways to make savings and possibly be a little bit more cognizant of that. when you know, actually, on the 25th of the month, 28th of the month, 1st of the month, whatever, I'm getting that guaranteed paycheck, that is when you're more likely to not think about, actually, what happens if I lose that job tomorrow? Or what happens if I lose that job tomorrow, but then can't get another job for an extended period of time? So that's been the first thing, is that actually we've been too confident. It's made us make really poor decisions. And this is where maybe even if we are confident, we need to start pulling back on what some of those decisions look like. The second thing is that everybody needs an emergency fund. And let me tell you something. There is a difference between an emergency fund and a savings account. Very, very different. Your emergency fund ideally should be 6 months of your financial commitments and expenses. So you want to have, I don't know, if it costs you £2,000 each month to pay your mortgage, your bills for, you know, your, I don't know, your car, your food, your main expenses, you know, to keep you and your family moving, you want 6 times that amount of money in an account somewhere that is acting as your emergency fund. That shouldn't necessarily be synonymous with your savings account, because your savings account should be saving with purpose, hopefully for investment, and therefore should be something separate. So if you haven't got an emergency fund, if the thought of not getting paid for 1 week or 1 month sent you into a cold sweat, now is the time to start thinking about how you can develop an emergency fund moving forward. And something is better than nothing. So, you know, as I say, if it's £2,000 a month, 6 times 2 is 12. You might think £12,000 is a lot of money. It's going to be really difficult to save all of that money. But here's the thing, even if you start with 50 quid, okay, that's £50 covered that you didn't already have before. So this is where it's a case of just getting started. Now, this is when we're realizing that another lesson is that developing multiple streams of income is much more important than we realize. And this is when I want to have a little bit of a conversation about diversification, okay? Because in the world of investing, and right now I'm teaching another money circle for investing. We've got one happening right at present. And at the moment, we're having a conversation about diversification. What does diversifying your portfolio mean? And a lot actually make mistakes with diversification, and you'll understand that if, for example, you do have multiple streams of income but all of them have been cut. That might suggest you're not diversifying very well. So I'm going to give you a very quick example. Let's say you're in the property game, okay? And so you have rented property, you purchased property to rent out to other people, okay? But then you think, well, I need to diversify. So I don't just want to do buy to let to long-term renters. Let me do some buy to lets where actually what we do is we do some short-term renters. So, you know, people who may actually use the room on, say, Airbnb or another, you know, platform where they can just come and rent a room for a short period of time, whether it's a holiday stay or whatever, and then go again. Okay, particularly when you've worked out, you can make a little bit more money often that way, even though there's more costs involved. So you think, I'm diversifying my streams of income. And indeed you are. But then all of the properties that you have purchased are in one particular area, let's say of Durham, okay? Just random, Durham. And one of the main employers into Durham is a big factory, okay? A big manufacturing factory that during the downturn, during coronavirus, has suddenly closed. And actually, all of your tenants, because they all live in that area, whether they are long-term or short-term, work for that factory or are impacted in their household by that factory closure directly or indirectly. That actually means that your diversification still hasn't worked, because you might have diversified your strategy for gaining income, but what you've done is you've over-concentrated in one particular area. Now, that is just one example of how diversification goes wrong when we think about multiple streams of income. So this is a really good time to actually think about really where diverse streams of income come from. And that can be about using different investment vehicles. That can be about being across different industries. That can be about even the way that you collect your money in your own business. You know, so for example, if you rely on online, well, what have you got that's offline, and vice versa? So this is a really, really, really good time to consider what true diversification looks like within your financial strategy. Because actually, a lot of us think that it just means I've diversified in one way, and that now means means that I'm safe. But in actual fact, because you haven't diversified in a number of ways, you will find that generally speaking, you are not safe. When we come back, I'm going to tell you a few more things that we can learn throughout the process of this pandemic. But in the meantime, it's the new one from Drake. And all I'm going to say is this. If you're watching online and you see me dancing in the studio, let's just call it I'm dancing to the music in the studio and not necessarily the music that you can hear. So I wonder if you can guess what song I'm playing.
Money matters.
Welcome back. It's coming up to 25 past 11 here on New Star Radio 98.7 FM. How are you all doing this morning? I'm Marisha here with you until midday, where of course each and every Saturday we make sure we make your money make sense. And this morning I'm also on New Star Radio Live on YouTube, so you can check us out there, and please do take a look. You get to see some of the things that go on in the studio, which includes me dancing really badly in between segments because I actually do enjoy the music that I play. Anyway, still to come this morning, I want to talk to you about lessons you can teach your children during this time if you're homeschooling, the sort of thing that you can teach them that they may not be learning at school. And I'm also going to talk to you about how you can profit from a recession, as in case, you know, it's not really been made that clear. We're about to go into one of those. But for the moment, I'm just sharing some lessons that we can learn from the current downturn and the pandemic that we've experienced, so that when we do go through another downturn in the economy, we can ensure that actually we fare a little bit better. So let's next time try to be in a lot less debt, because this is where actually businesses and individuals being in record debt compared to experience maybe the kind of debt we've had before has become something that's come to bite us in the butt, effectively. Debt is problematic, and when we are going through difficult times, you know, you're no longer in a position where you're just focused on trying to make ends meet. Now, the credit card bill or the loan payment or what have you that wasn't a major issue before, or you know, you were just about getting paid, now becomes extremely problematic. So please do consider ways in which to reduce debt moving forward. And often people will ask a question, what's more important, debt or savings? And what I often say to people is you want to try to deal with both if you can, and all you do is think about what's costing you more. So for example, if you have high cost debt, i.e. credit cards with APRs of 30%, loans with higher APRs, things of that nature, then it's a good idea to do what you can to reduce it. Student loans, mortgages, I wouldn't worry as much about, and as long as you're making the minimum payments on those, then you should be okay. Or if you're in a position where that payment's been taken out of your wage packet, then you know, that's fine. Overpaying that doesn't necessarily create very much benefit for you in the short term. But if you have expensive debts, try and get rid of those, and then as soon as you have, transfer that money into a savings pot. This is where, again, it's a good time to think about thinking for retirement. Now, the problem that we have, it goes back to this idea of overconfidence. So this idea that, you know what, it's okay, I've got time to get this sorted out. The market's good at the moment. I can, you know, I don't have to worry about investing, say, in my pension or whatever until a little bit later on. Or actually, property is going to be my pension strategy, so I'll just worry about that in a few years' time. This is where, again, overconfidence can get us into trouble. So we want to start thinking about retirement. And here's what I would say, frankly. If we all started thinking about retirement when we were thinking about getting our first jobs, i.e. we were planning our exit strategy from the beginning, actually, you'd find you'd retire a lot quicker. When you're sitting there now thinking, I've got another 30 years of work, and actually you're in your 50s, that doesn't feel like a very nice thought, or at least it wouldn't feel like a nice thought for me. So this is where actually thinking about retirement now is important. And I don't care if you're 21 or 75, you need to be thinking about what retirement's going to look like for you. This is where we now need to learn to live in a way where we have financial margin. So what do I mean by that? What I mean is, you know that little thing called disposable income? So i.e. the amount of money that you're paying out each month is less than the amount of money that you're earning. You want financial margin. And why? Because to put money in an emergency fund, to clear your debts, to develop some kind of retirement strategy, you need to have a little bit of excess cash. And actually, if you're earning £1,000 and you're spending £1,000, 999 or 1,001, you're going to run into problems real quick. So this is where you want to start working out financial margin. And often a really good way to actually do that initially is to do what I call a bill review. Nothing wrong with calling up the people that you pay your bills to and ask them how you can pay them less. Yeah, and they might go, I'm not sure. And you go, okay, then, well, I'm just going to go and pay somebody else, innit? I'll cancel my service with you and I'll go elsewhere. Act like you mean it and see if they don't start giving you discounts. And finally, and this one I think is actually about our attitude towards money, because I feel like money is energy. And in fact, I did a video on this ages ago about money standing for my own natural energy yield. And I do believe that. I believe there's a lot of things that are linked to our energy and the way that we put ourselves out in the world. Now, the point being is this: generosity is key. And, you know, actually small acts of generosity, and you might not have lots of money to give people, but, you know, offering to do shopping for your neighbours because they're struggling to get out at the moment is an act of generosity. You know, instead of chucking away half a loaf of bread, giving it to the family across the street who actually you spoke to last week, and you know that dad lost his job in the middle of the pandemic, is an act of generosity. You know, generosity can be generosity of spirit as well as generosity in terms of tangible goods or generosity of money. And this is when actually we get back out of the world what we put into it. And this is the time where, you know, when you kind of want somebody to look after you or something to look after you, it's where you can do your part to look after something as well. So I would say that actually the world just feels a little bit brighter when we're all a little bit more generous towards each other and not do things necessarily with any kind of motive other than just to give a little bit of love and add a little bit of value. Because here's the thing, I'm preaching my parents, they always use my mom in particular, you know, what goes up comes back down. They say don't kick people on your way up because you never know when you're going to come back down. And the reality is that there may be some of us at the moment who are in better financial positions than others, but we don't know if and when that could actually change. So you don't want to be in a position where you're, you know, looking down on people and saying, you need to sort out yourself and sort out your bills, to find out in 6 months' time that actually that's you in that position. So let us do what we can to support each other, to help each other out, to draw a little bit closer together, to recognize that money isn't everything, but it is a resource and a tool that we do need to take care of if we want it to take care of us. When we come back, what sort of lessons can you teach your kids to ensure that actually, again, when they have to weather some of the financial storms that are to come their way, they're slightly better equipped to deal with it? Well, we'll find out that and more before 12 o'clock. So don't go anywhere. There's still much to come.
Birmingham's number one for African arts, culture, and Afro.
Get a drum as a toy for Christmas.
FM. It's new style radio.
It's the Financial Style on New Style Radio 98.7 FM. Making money make sense.
Welcome back. How are you doing? That one that you were just listening to was Chris Brown and Summer Walker, Something Real. I really do like that track. So again, if you were watching on YouTube Live and you can see me dancing to a different beat to what you can hear, that's just the way that it goes. But if you want to hear some of the music going on in the studio, then don't forget to tune in to New Star Radio 98.7 FM. And I want to say as well, good morning to Cheryl. How are you doing, darling? It's really good to hear from you. So many of us are homeschooling at the moment, and it's a really good opportunity to actually teach your children the things that they may not be learning at school. Now, it's very easy to try and follow the curriculum. And I know that if I was a mum, I'd be that kind of mum. I'd be like, OK, what have you been learning this term? Okay, how do I Google everything and do all of the research at nighttime to figure out what it is? Because that's the problem with home teaching. You got to learn the stuff first so that you can teach your kids it the next day. And so, you know, I'd be that kind of mum. Like, I'd be asking all of those sorts of questions and probably do my child's head in. But actually, this is a really good time to focus on teaching our youngsters the things that maybe they're not learning in the school environment. And money and financial information is a really good one. And this is a time as well where we can use very practical lessons. So, you know, the good news is that you probably don't have to argue with them about why they can't have a, you know, happy meal, let's say, because at the end of the day, if the place is closed, it's closed. But it could be the time when you start talking to your children about maybe some of the ways in which they can make some of the financial decisions that they themselves can make that helps to provide them with lessons for a later time. So the first one is teaching kids how to budget. And do you know what? One thing I will say, and I say this as somebody who has taught children how to budget, they're often better at learning how to budget than adults, because children are much simpler, they're much quicker to make sacrifices. As soon as you say to them that in order for you to have X, you need to consider giving up, you know, Y, the child's like, listen, it's gone. I'm not even thinking about it anymore. So kids are pretty good at that. And actually helping them to have really simple budgets with, for example, their weekly or monthly allowance is an excellent way of teaching children value. And you can use it as a lesson. You know, I think about when we were kids and we used to play like little games as children amongst ourselves. And, you know, when you used to play shops, you know what I mean? And everybody would fight over who's going to be the shopkeeper, but, you know, who works the till and all this sort of stuff. But those are really effective ways of teaching children course subjects like maths, which, to be fair, if you've got a budget, you're going to need, etc. So think about that. And it's funny, actually, because playing shops is the next one on my list. So as I say, you know, kids love to play shops, like to pretend to be in a restaurant. So again, things like that. Maths is a good part of the lesson. But it's also good because you can teach them about things like team working, you know. So, OK, then not everybody can work on the till. Who's going to be the waiter? Who's going to take the order? Who's going to cook the pretend plastic food? You know, all of these sorts of things. But again, it can be really effective ways to teach your children lots of good lessons. Putting prices on chores. Now, I don't know about your parents, but I don't know, like, I feel like, did my mom do this? I feel like she did occasionally. I don't think she did it consistently, but I think she did it occasionally. So, you know, you'd want a little bit of extra money and it would be, well, listen, if you wash the car, you get a £5. If you, maybe I'm exaggerating, it might have been £1. If you hoover the floor, you get 50 pence, whatever the case may be. But putting a price on chores, I think, is a good one. And again, then that's the sort of money that they can earn as extras for treats. And again, it provides children with life lessons. It provides them with lessons to understand, hang on a minute, you know, often in order for me to gain more, I might have to do more, you know. And then you start getting the kids who learn how to think smart, because then, you know, they start, like, you know, bossing around their little brothers and sisters to do things, but make sure they collect the money, that sort of thing, you know. So whilst on one hand you kind of have to cuss them for exploiting their, younger siblings. On the other hand, you secretly congratulate them for being, you know, actually quite ingenious and knowing that they're the entrepreneur in the family. I'm just saying. It's those little things. And it's a good way actually to identify your children's financial personalities. We all have one of those. Are they the spender? Are they the saver? You know, that sort of question mark that actually you can answer when you engage in those sorts of activities. Teaching kids about good and bad spending. Okay, so again, if we're talking to them about budgeting, maybe they want to buy things online, but actually what is good and bad spending practices? So, you know, is it good to just panic and buy the first thing that you see? Or do you teach them that, you know what, maybe we need to think about this a little bit more. Maybe we need to give some consideration to deciding whether we really need it. Maybe we should look at what we want, go away, come back and then decide if we really want it. You know, those sorts of conversations that you can have with kids that are about good spending habits. Because, for example, I can be an impulse shopper. I am the child of an impulse shopper. It is not a good thing. That means you could go out of your house to go for a walk, okay, and come back £100,000 lighter. It's not a good thing. So I had to train myself to not impulse shop, hence I don't window shop, but that's because I understand my financial personality. So when you do that with your children, you start to understand what the personality is of your kids, and then you can start to manage how they do things and help them to manage themselves. Involving grandparents is a good thing, unless that grandparent is a spender. That's not always then a good thing, but then they could be used as anecdotal evidence of what your child should not be doing. And let's talk about tax with children. Let's not wait for kids to be adults before they hear about taxation. I would even think about ways in which to put that into their pocket money. So, you know, for example, if you say to them, switch off the TV at 9 o'clock because it's time for bed, and then they keep on the telly for an extra hour, you tax them as a way of saying that's the extra electricity that you use during the time when you were delinquent in the choices that you made. Like, yeah, see, my kids would be in trouble, you know. I don't think my kids would like me. I said it all the time, but I don't think my kids would like me. They'd have money though. They would have money. They would just cost their mother for some of the ways in which she taught them lessons. And another thing to consider, if you have a good understanding of stocks and shares, start teaching your children about those things as well. Involve them in those conversations, because you will be surprised how kids have an ability to absorb so much information. Same thing with things like interest rates. And that's why I say, you know, penalties, for example, for things that they do that they shouldn't do can be more effective than, you know, threatening to beat them or putting them on the naughty step. Do you know what I mean? Particularly for the child who's the Scrooge, who doesn't want to lose any money. Start charging them for their behavior. See if you don't see them fix up and fix up fast. So, you know, think about using ways in which you can manage what's happening in your household as a way of helping them to understand the value of things like money, time, hard work. See how you can incorporate that sort of thing. And then not every lesson has to feel like it's, you know, a 45-minute lesson where you must sit down and do your work. You can actually teach your children lots of valuable lessons through the pursuit of them just going about their day. And those lessons can continue even after they go back to school, which will help them actually make better decisions in their schoolwork. But more importantly, also help them make better decisions for their lives, which ultimately is what this is all about. For those of you who've been watching online, you'll know that I've been standing up for the last hour and a half. I'm tired now, but so I sat down for a little bit. I needed to sit down, but I still have a little bit more to come before the end of the show. And you must remember that you shouldn't go anywhere, because Paul Rubin with his aphrodisiac soul is up from 12 o'clock. And so, you know, he likes to put that soul music on you that you used to hear your parents playing. Maybe they're still playing it now, I don't know. But, you know, you want to make sure that you stick around for that. Anyway, for the people out there who right now, everything's going good. Maybe you got yourself a new job. Do you know what I mean? You're enjoying the time you're spending at home and with your kids. Let us appreciate what Future and Drake have to say about it.
Working on a weekend like usual. Way off in the deep end like usual.
With New Style Radio, you know, as much as you can, it is your local community radio station. We've been around for a minute, you know, we've been around for a while doing what we do. So check us out online, newstyleradio.co.uk. You can hit us up on socials as well, at New Style Radio on Instagram and on Twitter. And on Facebook, you'll find us under official New Style Radio 98.7 FM. Now, in every economic crash, there are winners and there are losers. A good example of that is the 2008 world economic crash that many of us remember because of the property market crashing with subprime loans and all of that technical stuff. Actually, whilst a lot of people lost their jobs and their homes, there were a few people who made not thousands, not millions, but billions. Now, you might not want to make some billions, but I can tell you something I don't know about you, but I wouldn't mind making a few coins as we're about to experience another crash. And so this morning I wanted to talk to you about actually how we can profit from there being recessions and how we can win when there is a market crash. Now, here's the thing. Recessions happen periodically, okay? We have what we call market cycles. And in a nutshell, what it basically means is what goes up comes back down and what comes down goes back up. So effectively, we will have cycles of activity that happen over a period of time. And those cycles, in terms of how much the market goes down or how much the market goes up, is going to just be dependent on the conditions that have sent it into that activity phase in the first instance. So to give an example, we had a very deep recession in 2008, as I say, as part of the economic crash. That was to do with the financial sector and banks crashing. And the impact of that invariably was that it was actually quite a deep recession. It affected people's jobs, it affected their homes, and it took us a while to recover. But then now we're having arguably what could be a much, much deeper recession, because for the first time in the modern era of global business, we have had to stop doing business all over the world. And certain industries that would have been considered hugely recession-proof are slap bang in the centre of this market crash. So the thing that we know is that they're going to happen, and there'll be a whole conversation to be had moving forward about maybe what some of the warning signs might look like. But some of the things to think about, actually, if you want to benefit from them, is thinking about what you need to have in place as and when these crashes happen. So one of them is cash, or at least access to money. Access to money and cash is not necessarily the same thing. So, for example, if you got a great credit history, that actually might be your way of accessing cash. But either way, access to cash. Okay, and it's important because if you want to profit during a recession, you want to be in a position where you actually still have cash that you can use during that recession. Why? It means that you will be able to buy the things that other people can't. Warren Buffett very famously said, cash is truly the king, and cash is the main ingredient if you want to profit from recessions, because effectively when there is a mega sale on, you want to be in a position to buy, and it's that simple. And so, for example, stocks and shares and things of that nature get bought up during market downturns when they're a lot cheaper by people who have the cash. The other thing is to be an owner and not a renter. So this is when ownership is really important. With recessions, you will see things being on sale. As I say, you want to be in a position where you can buy them up. If you're a renter, that's where actually it's not possible for you to do that. That also means you can benefit from bargain shopping because you can buy things a lot cheaper than would have been the case before. And again, you have the cash to do it. And it means that you can buy stocks, for example, at a really cheap price, where previously where other people are having to sell because they're trying to get hold of cash. And actually now you're in a position where you can focus on investing more in order to have a stronger investment portfolio. It also means that you're in a better position to refinance any deals that you have already at a better interest rate, and to take back some of your time, which effectively is what you're doing by buying into investments. It means that you're not exchanging your time for money. Instead, you're exchanging your money for more money, which is always going to be a beneficial approach to take. So you want to think about some of those as the key takeaways. It's about how you actually go into it in the first place. You want to make sure you're owning something and not renting it. You want to be in a position where you can shop when everybody else can't. You want to be in a place where you have the ability to hunt for good stock market options when nobody else can afford to keep theirs. They're selling them. It means you can buy. If needs be, it's a good time as well to refinance debt that you do have, so you can refinance it at a better rate because you're more credit worthy and more cash rich than maybe the people around you. And it allows you to take back some of your time, because actually by you investing more, you are buying back the time that you would have otherwise sold in order to gain some money. You can let your money gain the money for you instead. That's a bit of a whistle stop tour, but that's effectively how you will benefit from a recession. So I would love to know what your confidence is like at the moment, and whether you feel like you will be in a position to actually benefit from what's going on at the moment. And if you're not yet, what you're maybe thinking about that would be good or advantageous for you, so that moving forward you can benefit. Because just because you may not be cash rich right in this minute, still doesn't mean that there aren't going to be opportunities for you moving forward. So it's just about thinking about how you can prepare yourself better for those. So I'd love for you to communicate that with me. For the people that have been listening online this morning, thank you so much. Thank you for your company. Please do drop some comments below and, subscribe to New Style Radio Live, because there'll be lots of other shows that get put on the station live, like mine has this morning, for you to get a flavour of all of the different types of shows that are actually on air on 98.7 FM. For those of you listening on air or online via a different medium, thank you so much for your company. I will be, of course, back same time, same place next week to make sure that your money makes sense. Coming up next, you do have Paul Rubin with Aphrodisiac Soul. People have a blessed and safe and enjoyable bank holiday weekend, and I look forward to seeing you next week. I'm going to leave you with this one from Hood Celebrity. It's called Run the Road. And all I can say is we can't run the road yet, but run the garden and see how it feels for the sunny weekend.